You hardly talk to me anymore when I come through the door at the end of the day.
Have you noticed how often our relationships with life and with each other shift and get different? And we have these expectations of what it's supposed to look like, and then it's changing and morphing into something else that doesn't feel the same. Well, I'm going to talk about this idea. I like the song, the lyrics of this song by Neil Diamond and Barbara Streisand. You don't bring me flowers anymore. I'm expecting you to bring me flowers. I'm expecting you to show me love and shower me with all these good things, and it's just not happening anymore. And this is whether we're talking about our relationships with each other, intimate relationships, our relationship with life in general, relationship with grandchildren. Those relationships shift and change and morph. Children grow older, everything changes. So I'm going to talk about this idea that David Rico teaches in everything, five things you can't change. Help me. Five things you cannot change, David Rico. We study this book in Women's Wisdom. And he says one of the givens of life is that people are not loving and loyal all the time. Have you noticed? Have you experienced that in your life? Relationships go a long way in determining how happy we are. Isn't that the truth? If relationships are rocky, and if they don't feel good, and if we feel separate, like Linda was talking about, we feel displaced, we don't feel connected, the way we feel about our life journey, our soul journey, is different than if we feel really connected, like we're in a relationship, in a good, healthy, loving relationship. You know, we have a lot of expectations about how we want our relationships to show up. The flower thing, right? And what I've experienced in relationships with family, intimate relationships, with grandchildren, with friends, with life in general, is that these relationships have wonderful highs, and guess what? They have these huge lows. Have you noticed how this works? These wonderful, joyful, rich, beautiful experiences, and then it doesn't take very long for the flip side to happen. It can happen through loss, it can happen through betrayal, it can happen through distance, it can happen through a lot of different things. But the fact of the matter is our relationships with each other and with the world go through changes. We're in a dynamic experience. We are in a sort of a responsive experience to life. And our capacity to be present enough to respond to the changes of life, not only in our relationships with each other, but with life itself, has a lot to do with their sense of well-being, with how comfortable we feel living the life that we're living. We have to take responsibility for the heart space of our relationship to life and to each other. And most of the time, it's about getting our ego self out of the way, getting this little self out of the way, and remembering the truth, and that is that my humanity is a field for the expression of my divine self. And if I can remember that in all my relationships, that's great. But what I want to tell you is that that doesn't always happen. You know, we have this, our humanity requires us to come together in groups, to be in relationship with each other. It's practical, isn't it? It's practical. It feels good. It feels good to come together. Christian tradition, where two or more are gathered, this idea of coming together to share the vibrational field of commonality. It's very practical. Basic survival needs. We got to come together because we're all dependent on each other. That's fact. That's an absolute fact. And so what I know about this is that we have these personal relationships and then we have soul relationships. And what I really want to talk about, I want to stay kind of on the personal relationship level today. Because what I know is that when we show up in our humanity, wherever we are, is a sacred holding ground for the laboratory of our humanity. And that place, wherever we are, whoever we're with, like Glenda said, is that holy encounter. It's that place where we have an opportunity to give and receive love, to give and receive appreciation, to give and receive acceptance, to give and receive allowing one another to be who we are, to give and receive affection, to give and receive attention. I see you. You're important. You make a difference to me. See, that's what relationships are all about. Doesn't matter what kind of relationship it is. At the human level, it's all about being seen and appreciated and accepted and getting that sense of relationship that's about affection and heart connection and allowing us to be who we really are. That's what relationships at the human level are about. But this is where it gets tricky because, you see, Glenda talked a lot about love, and I'm talking about love too, because love is who we are. But what I want to tell you is we don't have to like everybody. We don't have to like everybody. Loving everybody is one thing. Liking everybody is a whole other ballgame. See, there's this inner and outer aspect of our relationship with life and with. We don't have to like everything. We don't have to condone everything. This is what brings us into our oneness with all of life, is if we have the capacity to say, I love you, I see you, I know who you are, and guess what? I don't condone your behavior. Guess what? I don't choose to put myself in the field of energy that doesn't feel right for me. Do you hear what I'm saying? So at the soul level, at the inner level, yes, we love everybody and we become as skillful as we can. And the more practiced we are, the closer we get to what Glenda was talking about, where we just show up as love, where this agape being that just radiates love and this sort of thing all the time. But that's not my experience. That's not my experience. So my invitation is to recognize your humanity, strive and work toward that loving no matter what sort of thing. And remember, we're human and we don't have to like everybody. We don't have to like everything. And by the way, when we're talking about relationships, look at Facebook. We collect friends, don't we? It's not about how many friends we have. It's not about let's do lunch. We can have a relationship with life, with our experience, with the people that are in our life experience, and we don't have to go around collecting cows. You know, some people think the more friends you have, the more relationships you have and the more whatever. That's just not true. That's not true. We have a lot of acquaintances sometimes. I'm talking about those deep relationships that help our souls grow. Help us, like the relationship Glenda and I have, that holding environment for soul growth. See, because a lot of times when we're involved in these relationships with people, we all get our knots in a knicker because people don't show up the way we want them to show up. And then we get mad at each other, right? And then we don't have this is how I want it, and it's not showing up the way I want it, so I'm not going to be in a relationship with you anymore. Do you know how that works? Have you been there? Have you done that? I want the relationship to look like this. I want it to look like this. So this is the thing. You don't have to like everybody, but you do love everybody. You have that heart connection from a divinity standpoint. But what we can do, and this is where our relationship with life comes, if you're holding on to a grudge or a resentment or drama or the past or baggage about anybody in your field of energy or your field of relationships, if you're holding the baggage, this is where the work comes. Because you don't have to like the person, but you do have to have a clear space within yourself that isn't about judgment, that isn't about resentment. You can reach that sort of neutral place where you can see who they are for who they are. Doesn't mean that you put yourself in harm's way. But the more you hold on to a relationship that's toxic for you at the heart level, the less well-being you're going to feel. It takes courage to do this. It takes courage to be able to embrace the unskillfulness of somebody else and forgive that and be humble around those things. Because what gets in the way is that we're afraid of letting these kinds of things touch our hearts. You see, we're afraid of letting people's unskillfulness touch us. And so we have to be willing to see this other person for who they are, maybe not like them so much, but know that they are divine just like we are. Move past the offense. Hey, ever have a bad day? Ever make a mistake? Ever be in a rotten mood? Ever put your foot in your mouth and criticize somebody and have it damage your relationship? Ever have that happen? Ever have that happen to you? The more mindful we are, the more responsible we are for our way of showing up in our experience, the less relationship disasters we are going to create. Good enough relationships without the judgment, without the resentment, without the blame, without the judgment, without the criticism. So how do we do it? Look past whatever's gone on, the past mistakes, and stay very present with it. Let everybody be reborn again in your relationship with them. There is no relationship that cannot be reborn. Again, it doesn't mean that you necessarily have to be present with that relationship. It's about forgiveness work, where you can clear your own path, your own heart, so that your relationship with that idea, with that thought, with that experience shifts, like Linda says. Surrender the thought that you have to be right. It's not my job to let make everybody, you know, do what I want them to do. Learn how to disagree with love. Be present with love. Be careful what you say. Try to be mindful, you know, the Buddhist tradition. Right thought, right speech. Be mindful with what you say and how you say it. Allow your heart to soften and hold your tongue, no matter what. If you feel like you've got to, you know, speak your mind, so many people want to speak their mind, speak your mind with love, and remember that what you say will have an impact. Remember that when we encounter people with who I am right now and who you are right now, not who I was and who you were, things are going to be a lot better, a lot better. Love without conditions, love anyway. See if you can step into that sacred field where you allow the relationships in your life to feed you and to grow you beyond the resentments that you may have. Take care of yourself. Don't put yourself in harm's way. Sometimes it's not appropriate for us to be present with certain individuals or certain experiences. But you can always send out love. Because when you don't send out love and you withhold it, you're going to get that same response back. Nothing you ever say or do can stop me from loving you if I choose to do that. I love that saying. Nothing you ever say or do can ever stop me from loving you. I've got a grandson I haven't seen for a long, long time, and that's my mantra. That's my mantra. He's not around. He's not, probably not going to be around. He's a young man now. And who knows how things shift? That's what I'm saying about you never know how things are going to go. Everything changes. Everything's dynamic. I want it to be a certain way, and it's not. But what I know is that I can love anyway. People are not always loving and loyal, but I can love anyway, and I don't have to put myself in harm's way because I can love from a heart level as a whole encounter with the energy of that experience and that relationship. So when in doubt, just rely on the lyrics of this song. It looks like my boxer at my house, although my boxer is much bigger. If you ever have a doubt and you want to figure out how to repair a relationship that doesn't feel quite right, send flowers. Thanks for listening. So, thank you.